I hope you all can see my screen and also can hear me well. Can you confirm, Anil Kumar?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, sir. It is visible, sir.
Okay, it's visible. Okay, good.
Yes, sir. We can see, sir. Please go ahead.
Thanks. So, I will talk a little bit about that, why we need this thing, that genomics assisted breeding. For some of you, this may be looking new term, but I will discuss and where we are now and where we would like to reach. So first is, two things are very important for everybody. Only two things, and other than two, there may be many other, but two are basic things. One is health, and we all are aware about the importance of health in the present day, especially because of the COVID challenges. Second, food. And this food comes through the agriculture. And as we know, that the world population is continuously increasing. We already are right now around 7 billion people in the world, which will be reaching around 9 billion in next 20 years or so. In the context of India also, population growth is a continuous process. We already now 1.3 billion people. So now the question is that how we can feed this population. For that, agricultural community, agricultural science community needs to continue to develop the varieties, the better varieties, higher production, the varieties which can cope up the diseases, can fight with the bacteria, virus, etc., can handle these so they can handle these pests, they can handle that abiotic stresses like drought, salinity, etc. Nowadays we are having lots of emphasis on the nutrition also. So idea is we should have the varieties which are providing more crop productivity. Secondly, when we are developing the better varieties, we should not be disturbing environment. So environmental sustainability is very important. So this is basically crop improvement, where several disciplines of agriculture science, including breeding, biotechnology, pathology, entomology, they help. And agricultural scientists, they are always interested to develop the better varieties. But now, and this is a bit technical thing, especially for that agriculture, biotechnology, and agriculture breeding students, how these agriculture scientists are developing the varieties, what kind of genetic gains they are making. Genetic gains means that last year, how much gain you had, the next year, how much you will have. And this genetic gain in the breeding is directly proportional to the selection intensity, selection accuracy, genetic variance, and inversely proportional to years per cycle. I will not go in this detailed formula, but those of you who are interested, they can read this paper recently published, that how we can use the genomics and breeding innovations for enhancing the genetic gain, so we can address each of these component of the breeding equation. And again, I will not go in the detail. Maybe those of you who are interested, they can read. But now let's come back to this thing, that, well, how we are doing this thing. So basically at ICRISET, we work on three legume crops, chickpea, pigeon pea, and groundnut. And three cereal crop, basically sorghum, finger millet, and pearl millet. So this is the way that we have been working on those different crops. And if you see these crops, then the crop productivity is very, very low. Basically, nowadays, or not nowadays, for last several years, in chickpea, pigeon pea, and groundnut, the crop productivity is less than 1 ton per hectare. Similar is the case in many cereal crops. And especially this becomes much more serious when these crops, they are grown in marginal environments in Asia and Africa, where we don't have much irrigation, we are not having really good soil. So in those kind of situations, the crop productivity is less. So in this presentation, I will be talking more some of our efforts in chickpea, pigeon pea, and groundnut. How we are doing this thing? So basically, as you know, that everyone, either this is animal, human being, plants, insects, or anything, how do they look like, how they are, how they will behave, everything is controlled by the genes. And the genes, they are present, as we know, in the nucleus, right? So basically, all the gene repertoire of an organism is called genome. So basically, if we would like to understand that the feature of any individual, we need to understand the genome. Now, if we can understand the genome, that which genes are responsible for biotic stress resistance or abiotic stress tolerance, then we can use those genes in the breeding program to help breeding. And this process, we call it genomics assisted breeding. I will tell in a bit detail later. Now, before we go to these genome sequencing and these things, let's understand that, well, how whole this process started. And I can understand that there are many students who have read the genetics, they understand genetics. So basically, you see, this is the chromosome and this is the DNA threads. And this is a long history. I will not go in the long history, starting from the Mendel's law, 1865, then double helix structure of DNA in 1953, a lot of stuff happened. But main thing about the genome is it started in 1990 in the United States with the emphasis on the human health, because they think that all the diseases in that human, they are controlled by genes. So in the case, if we can identify those genes, then we can develop the genomic medicines. And with this objective, many countries, they joined hands together. They embarked on this human genome sequencing project. In 2003, after 13 years, and after the investment of $3 billion, they completed this genome. In fact, this process is continuous because you are having every day some new technologies and you need to keep on improving. What does it mean? You can see, for instance, many of you, or not many, all of us have been watching TV, but if you see televisions, TV sets of 80s versus 90s, 2000, now 2010, 2020, you can see the evolution in this TV technology. Sometimes they were very fat TV, then they became slim. They're having plasma, LCD, LED. So the same process happens in the genomics technologies. So you can have keep on having the new sequencing technology. People keep on using these technology, and then they keep on coming with that new improved version of the genomes. So human genome, in fact, completed in 2003. These are the different research papers. But now even this year also, 2 or 3 weeks back, there was another version, and in human, we are having basically 3 gigabase pair. And now they have completed the whole genome sequencing of human. Still, there are 0.3% of the sequencing error. Anyway, we did, when I say we, basically scientific community, the world community, they completed this human genome. And this has been very, very helpful during last several years for developing the medicine. You might have seen in the current scenario, in the last 2-3 years, because of this coronavirus, genome were sequenced very fast. Vaccines were developed very fast. Otherwise, in the human history, we never had so fast vaccine development, because now it was possible to sequence the genome very easily. Nowadays, you might have heard this new version, Delta Plus, etc. And these are all coming through the sequencing, because based on the sequencing, you can detect the nucleotide, either you can call that this is the mutation, this is the variant. So again, friends, I just want to emphasize the power of the sequencing technology. And in fact, several journals of the Nature, they have done a milestones in the genome sequencing to try to review what kind of sequencing technology we had. I used to be one of those milestone advisor to provide some of these inputs, especially from the plant genomics perspective. So in the case of this sequencing thing is happening, and now we are in very much advanced stage. Now, I would like to take you back 15 years back in 2005. In 2005, or in fact, I was in Germany in the 2000 to 2005. So in the 2000, we had the first genome of a plant species called Arabidopsis. In 2002, we got some draft genome of rice. In 2005, we got the first improved version or complete, or I should say high quality genome of rice. Many genome sequencing projects were just starting. And then we recognized that, well, now how the genomics technology, genome sequences can be used in the breeding program. So in the 2005, in the special issue of the Trends in Plant Sciences of the 10th anniversary, issue was the Feeding the World Plant Biotechnology Milestone, we gave a concept of this genomics assisted breeding. And as you can see that, well, that genomics assisted breeding for crop improvement, we gave this technological aspects, how genomics technology will be useful for accelerating breeding process, crop improvement process, so that we can develop, scientific community can develop better varieties, and these better varieties reaches to the farmers. So this concept came in 2005. Now, after 15 years in 2020, we had the 25th anniversary special issue of the Trends in Plant Science. And they are talking, well, we have done a lot of progress. Now, what is the future of the plant breeding? And then they asked us also, and then we gave a concept of the genomics assisted breeding 2.0, or the future of the genomics assisted breeding, with several colleagues from India, United States, Germany, etc. And here I will tell that what is the future of these breeding. So this is basically, I wanted to tell in this presentation, we will talk where we are. So what is the present of the genomics assisted breeding, and what is the future of the genomics assisted breeding. Now, when you would like to go in the genomics assisted breeding, first you need to understand the genome sequence. And for that, we need to decode the genomes. And at ICRISAT, together with our colleagues and collaborators, we have sequenced the genomes of several crops, including pigeon pea, chickpea, pearl millet. Groundnut is a tetrapod groundnut, and there are the two different wild species. So we sequenced initially two wild species, and recently we also sequenced the tetrapod, especially in this Nature Genetics paper. Professor P.V. Kavikishore was also our collaborator in one of this paper of that tetraploid groundnut also. So we have been sequencing the genomes, and this is a huge work, but through the collaboration with the partnership and with the power of the technology, we were able to complete the genome sequence of all these crops. Not only that, we have sequenced sesame, mung bean, ajuki bean, jatropha, pea, long and many sequences. So in fact, we feel very happy, very proud to say that ICRISAT Center of Excellence in Genomics has led or co-led genome sequencing of more than 10 different crops, which is a very, very important feature for us. So anyway, so once you do the genome sequencing, from the genome sequence, you can identify through the bioinformatics approaches, prediction approaches, that how many genes you have in these crops. So for instance, in the case of chickpea, 28,000 genes. So we have, but now next point will be how we can associate these things with the different traits, that which gene is associated with drought tolerance, which gene is associated with the disease resistance. To address this issue, nowadays there is a concept of pangenomics. So what is pangenomics? I will tell in a minute. What happens if you sequence one cultivar? Cultivar means line of variety. So like for instance, you have sequenced this yellow color. Somebody has sequenced cultivar 2, this one, and somebody has sequenced the cultivar 3. Now, when we do the analysis of all these three genomes, we realize that some genome sequence is common across all the three cultivars, called core genome. Some are common between two genotypes. This is called dispensable genome. some is unique. So sometimes some of your varieties may have some specific genes which are specific to this variety. And if you have not sequenced this variety, then you don't have the information about those genes. You will have the information about only this and this. So what we need to do, we just do not need to sequence just one genome, but several genomes if you would like to understand the genome architecture, gene repertoire of that particular species. This is called pangenome. So basically you try to analyze all these genomes across across the varieties of a given species. Recently, we also have given a concept of super pangenome. And this super pangenome extends across the species for that one genera. So like for instance, in the case of chickpea, Sicer aeritinum is a cultivated chickpea variety, but Sicer genus is having 8 different species. And what we propose that for each of these Sicer 8 species, we should have a pangenome. So one pangenome for Sicer reticulatum, one is for Sicer cunetum, one for the pangenome for Sicer yamaceti, like that one. And when we are having these pangenome for the different species, then we bring them together and we develop the super pangenome. So super pangenome is the pangenome of several species. So this is the way that we are moving ahead. Now, with this objective to understand these genes across the cultivars or varieties of that species, we sequenced the pigeon pea reference set. So what does it mean that we have taken more than about 300 pigeon pea lines collected from different parts of the world. You can see this thing, the different parts of the world. We did the whole genome sequencing. And we also did the phenotyping of these lines. Phenotyping means how do behave. Huh? So like for instance, in the case of drought, if they are resistant, tolerant, susceptible, what? For the disease like that one. So we did the phenotyping of all these 292 pigeon pea exosomes and associated the sequencing variations for the different traits, and we identified genes associated with the different traits like days to maturity, days to flowering, harvest index, etc. So this is the way that we are moving. Similarly, in the case of chickpea also, we sequenced 300 lines. And here you can also see the name of Professor Kavi Kishore. And he was part of this big project. And we are very happy to work with him, to have association with him. So in this project also, we sequenced more than 429 chickpea exosomes from the 45 countries. And after sequencing, we have analyzed the genome diversity. We have analyzed the domestication, where chickpea was domesticated, how chickpea moved from one continent to other continent. So this is the way that we did, and also tried to identify the genes associated with the agronomic traits. Agronomic traits means yield, disease resistance, etc. So now, based on these work, we also have recently sequenced more than 1,000. Can I request all the participants to mute their mic if they are not speaking? I think right now I'm speaking, so please don't mute my mic, but mute mic for all the other colleagues. Okay, so now, after this chickpea and pigeon pea, these several hundred genome sequencing, now we have completed the sequencing of chickpea, more than 3,000 lines coming from all over the world. Now we are doing this pangenome analysis, and also in the case of pangenome, for instance, in the case of 3,000, and as you see, that as number of individuals increase, number of individuals is increasing, then this genes or this pangenome initially increase, but then this becomes static, and core genome keeps on going down. So basically, we are trying to understand all these genomic features across that chickpea line. So once you got the genome sequence in your hands, you got gene repertoire in your hands. Now the next question is that you need to associate those genes with that breeding traits. But for that, what we need to do, that we work with the breeders. And what breeders do, that they are having the segregating population, breeding population. They are developed by making the cross of one genotype with the other genotype. They got the population, they got the phenotyping data in the field. But now, if you would like to do this association analysis, you need to genotype, you need to sequence that population also. For that, we need to have the cost-effective genotyping platform. So now, we have developed several cost-effective genotyping platform, including SSR marker, genotyping by sequencing, whole genome resequencing. So what is it? 56,000 SNP array. So what does it mean? That if you would like to analyze the genome of any individual, if you use this platform, you can screen 56,000 SNP in a single go. You can do the whole genome resequencing of that particular line. So from these, so basically we developed the genomes genotyping platform, and now it is for each of our crop, we got a range of the genotyping platforms, starting from the 10 SNP panel, quality control panel, targeted GBS, and also the Axiom Sizer SNP array. And we are using these different genotyping panels for different analysis, for different plant breeding purposes. For instance, this SNP array was used to identify the markers associated with the helicorpus. This is an insect. This is the chickpea pod. And you can see this insect is going inside the pod and basically damaging the plant. But now we got the markers associated with this trait. And with the help of these markers, we can develop the varieties that even if the insect comes on the pod, will not be able to penetrate the pod. So this is the way that we are moving ahead. Friends, I was talking about the genome sequence. I was talking about that how we identify these genes across the different species, pangenomics approach. Then I was talking about the genotyping platform. And as I said, so then we work with the breeders. They are having the biparental mapping population. Sometimes they have the multiparental population. Sometimes the diverse set. And we genotype these populations. We phenotype these populations and then associate the link or associate a trait with the gene. And by using these approaches and some new genetic mapping approaches, I will not go in the detail because this is a very technical thing, but I just want to tell that by combining these approaches, we try to identify the genes associated with different agronomic traits. For instance, and by using these kind of approaches, in each of our crop species, we have mapped 20 to 50 traits. What it means, like in the case of chickpea, drought tolerance, heat tolerance, salinity tolerance, ascochyta blight, helicorpus. So for each of these things now, we have got the genes marker associated with the trait. Same thing for groundnut, leaf rust, late leaf spot, iron deficiency. In the case of pigeon pea, we are having the hybrid pigeon pea breeding. So we got the genes associated with the hybrid related traits, seed purity kits, yield related traits. So what I want to tell that by using so much genomic resources, we were able to map 20 to 50 traits. And these are the important traits for which breeders are interested to develop the variety. So for instance, if you talk the chickpea, you may have very many varieties, but they are not very high yielding under drought. You may have many varieties, but you would like to develop more varieties which are the heat tolerant in the context of the climate change, because you know that climate change is happening. You need to develop the varieties for future, which can be, which are resistant or tolerant to the heat, salinities, all these things. So what we do that for all these traits, we got these markers and then we go for the marker validation. And once we get some of these validation, then we use them in the breeding processes. So now, after that, we would like to translate all this genomics research to the breeding. And here you can see the plots at a set from our groundnut breeding. And you can see these are the groundnut lines, and some of them you see that they are not very good because we have improved those lines. We have converted those lines like that. So, so we are translating this research to the field. And for that, we use these breeding approaches. In the present time, we are using marker-assisted selection, marker-assisted recurrent selection. In future, or even we started to use some new approaches called haplotype-based breeding, genomic selection, gene editing. So these approaches are being used and in future will be used in combination with the speed breeding. Now, I will like to give some example of present day of genomics assisted breeding, that how we have developed some of these improved lines. First example is about chickpea. So in chickpea, like many other crops, if you don't have enough water in the soil, then these varieties do not produce much yield. Based on our work of our crop physiologists, crop breeders, they figured out that if a plant is having the higher root land density, higher root biomass, then they will be able to extract more water from that soil, and then they should be able to perform their physiological activities, they can deliver more yield. So what we did, some of the varieties like JG11, we have developed the more by using this marker assisted selection, genomics assisted breeding approach. We developed several new lines which are having higher rootland density than this JG11. You can see that many lines, they got much more bigger roots, rootland density, etc. Then these lines were tested multi-location in India, in Ethiopia, in Kenya, etc. And after very rigorous testing or so, one of these lines was released as the first ever marker-assisted backcrossing variety for chickpea in the case of Ethiopia. And this variety was named on after the name of a famous pulse geneticist of Ethiopia, Jeletu. And this variety is having higher grain yield, up to 3.8 tons per hectare in several locations. And these are some of these Ethiopian colleagues. So basically, in collaboration of Ethiopian Institute of Agriculture Research, ICRISAT has developed some lines, and these lines have been released as a drought-tolerant variety in the case of Ethiopia. So this is a story how you take this research from the genomics to the breeding program and to take to the farmers. Similar is the case here in India also, from the Indian Agriculture Research Institute of Indian Council of Agriculture Research, Dr. Bhardwaj, who is a chickpea breeder. And Bhardwaj and we work together, and then they have developed one variety called Pusa Chickpea 10216. This is drought tolerant variety, and this was released in India in 2019. And here you can see that this is having even 16% higher yield than its recurrent parent Pusa 372. Also good protein content. So this is another success story in the field from the genome. So you can say that how we are taking this information from genome to the field. Another success story of genomics assisted breeding in the present age, I would like to tell about Super Anigri variety. Dr. Mannur, he used to be a chickpea breeder in University of Agriculture Sciences, Raichur. He developed a variety long back in 80s, Anigri. But during last 20 years, Anigri variety became susceptible for fusarium wilt. Before his retirement, few years before his retirement, he started to work with us. He wanted to ensure that the variety Anigri 1 becomes again robust variety. So then for that, we use this marker assisted selection approach, and we have converted this fusarium wilt susceptible variety into the fusarium wilt resistant variety. And this fusarium wilt resistant Anigri variety, Dr. Mannur says Super Anigri. And this Super Anigri 1 is having the high yield advantage. Similarly, we have also developed another improved version of JG74 in Madhya Pradesh. So in several states, these lines are coming. This year in 2021, IRI, Dr. Bhardwaj Group, also released one new variety called Pusa Chickpea Manav. And this variety is also fusarium wilt resistant. So this is another success story. So I'm trying to tell that sometimes we think that biotech is just good for publication, genomics research is good for publication, not for product development. And here are the success stories that how you can develop the better varieties. And this is the recent paper, and I'm very happy to see this paper. You can see many scientists involved in this paper. They are coming from the Government of India's Institute like ICR, IRI, Indian Institute of Pulses Research, and of course, ICRISAT, and funded. This work was funded from the Ministry of Agriculture as well. Here in this paper presents the development of drought tolerant and high yielding varieties in three chickpea cultivars, Pusa 372 and Pusa 362, DCP 92-3. And in each of these three genetic background, we have developed the improved lines and they're moving ahead. Not only here in India, but even in United States, some like American Society of Agronomy, Crop Science Society of America, Soil Society of America, they highlighted recently our research by mentioning breeding a better chickpea. Same thing here in India also. They talk in the general newspapers that how genomics can be helpful to develop India's super chana. So I think that these are really good success stories. And now several other institutes like Indian Institute of Pulses Research, they're also developing the Fusarium wilt resistant variety by following the same approach. In the case of pigeon pea also, in collaboration with the PJTSU, Telangana State Agriculture University, and also in many other states, we are developing several improved lines of the pigeon pea for Fusarium wilt and Escherichia mosaic disease resistant. In the case of groundnut is another success story where we have developed better varieties in collaboration with the Directorate of Groundnut Research. And here you can see that majority of the groundnut varieties, you see groundnut is an oilseed crop. If you see its oil composition, then right now this is having linoleic acid, red color thing is not good for health. Then you are having this palmitic acid, this is having oleic acid. In United States and many other countries, that many groundnut varieties, they are high oleic, basically more than 80% of the oleic acid, and you can see very minimal amount of the linoleic acid. Now, by using this genomics assisted breeding approach, we develop new lines. These are the new lines in the genetic background of ICGV 06420. And here you can see that each of these lines are having more than 80% oleic acid. In India, develops new groundnut lines, Grenar 4 and Grenar 5. They were identified last year. They were released this year. In fact, last year when Prime Minister Modi, he dedicated 17 biofortified crop varieties to that country on the World Food Day, then our two varieties, groundnut Grenar 4 and Grenar 5, they were also part of this whole package of the 17 crop varieties. And these varieties, they were developed through the genomics assisted breeding. Not only us, now our partners like Directorate of Groundnut Research, they are also developing now, collaborating with us, developing the varieties which are having the high oleic acid. All these things, blue color thing is the oleic acid. You can see in many cases, they are reaching 75-80% like this kind of thing. So this is the way that things are moving now. The last example I would like to tell about the foliar disease resistance. And then foliar disease resistance like late leaf spot, leaf rust, and now we have developed the varieties through marker-assisted back crossing and they are in the field. And you can see that they are really very good. And not only in India, our collaborators in Nigeria and Ghana and other places also. And we have tested these lines and many of these lines, they're really working very nicely and their response to the diseases is fantastic. In Karnataka state, and one of these gentlemen, Dr. Ramesh Bhatt, and we worked together, and at that time we had this agriculture minister in Karnataka a few years back. This was the groundnut product developing through the molecular breeding. This is the JL24. You can see there is nothing. Now in the same genetic background, Dr. Bhatt and colleagues, they developed DVG3 variety. TMB2, nothing, because everything is damaged by those diseases. Now the DVG4, the new variety. So these DVG3, DVG4, these varieties have also been released in Karnataka state. And these are that you can see the spot size, yield, etc. So this is the success story of genomics assisted breeding in different crops, chickpea, pigeon pea, and groundnut. Here, as I said earlier, we are having now foliar digestion line, high oleic lines. Now we are combining these things together. And when you bring these genes together, you call the process gene pyramiding. And now you can see here, this side is having the trial of foliar disease susceptible line. This side is having the resistant line. And you can see very clear difference between these two plots. So this is the way the genomics assisted breeding is happening. So friends, I talked about the genomes. I talked about the genomics assisted breeding. the present time. Now, where we would like to go, where these things are moving further. In this direction, as I said, so we have given this concept of the GAV 2.0. What we are saying that not only those approaches, there will be many more approaches. How? In gene bank, in many countries, for each crop, we are having hundreds to thousands of the exosomes. Now, these exosomes can be sequenced by using high throughput sequencing machine. These genotypes can also be phenotyped with the state-of-the-art phenomic platforms. Now, by combining these things together, we can identify the genes. And not only the genes, you can identify the haplotypes. Haplotypes means variation of those genes. And these haplotypes, when you identify, they can be used in the haplotype-based breeding. Sometimes even you can identify the nucleotide, which is good. Now we call it beneficial allele. And for that, you can use the gene editing approach. But for some allele, they may not be very good. They may be harmful allele. You can also purge, you can also delete those alleles through the gene editing. So other thing is that by using this diversity and the good feature, you can also use the new approaches of genomic prediction or genomic selection. So basically call them optimal contribution selection. And now the other thing is speed breeding. So if you will combine these approaches together with the speed breeding, then you can accelerate your breeding processes. So what I was talking and some quick example of future of the genomics assisted breeding is haplotype based breeding. What is haplotype? So when you sequence the genome, you are having the genes. And for each gene, you have these nucleotide ACGT. Across the different genotype, you can identify the haplotype. Now, for instance, these are the genotypes. These are different genes. For genotype 1, you got H1 haplotype. You got H1 haplotype for gene 2. You got haplotype H2 for the gene 3. Once we got these haplotypes, we also do the phenotyping. Phenotyping now, for instance, leaf area, root depth, flowering time, yield. Based on these phenotyping analysis, we identify that, okay, for leaf area, H3 haplotype is good. For root depth, haplotype H1 is good. For flowering time, this haplotype is good. So based on these things, you identify the better haplotypes. And once you have like haplotype 3, haplotype 1, haplotype 2, haplotype 3, so by combining these haplotypes together, we call through the breeding process, we call haplotype-based breeding. So basically, you replace the inferior haplotypes by the superior haplotypes. And this process is called haplotype-based breeding. In the case of pigeon pea, we already started for the drought tolerance related trait. And here you can see that by sequencing the pigeon pea germplasm, we identified the haplotypes, good haplotypes for the different trait. And now we are moving ahead. And here is an example of a variety called Maruti. Maruti is a pigeon pea variety, very leading variety in Karnataka, in Telangana state or so. But now when we analyzed, we found that they are having the inferior haplotypes. So the thing is, by using this haplotype-based analysis, we would like to replace these haplotype with that new haplotype. And if we can convert these old haplotypes, inferior haplotypes into the new haplotypes, we can develop the Maruti variety from this to this, and which will be very much superior. So this is one approach of haplotype-based breeding. Second approach is about the genomic prediction. And what this genomic prediction approach is, that earlier or nowadays, many breeders, they are selecting the lines for making the cross based on one or two gene or locus. But now it is possible to sequence or genotype the breeding population, and we can make the prediction based on these data that which line will be having higher breeding value. And by doing these things, we call this process genomic prediction, or you select the lines based on the whole genome-wide data called genomic selection. And based on these things, you can have the genomic selection approach. And for that, you need to have the genomic resources. We got it. We need to have the databases. We got it. We need to have the phenotyping platform. We have. And we need to have the expertise. So by combining these things together, we can develop a good pipeline, genomic selection breeding pipeline. And by using the genomic selection pipeline, you can develop the better lines, or also you can reject the poor lines which are not good. So you can use both purposes, positive selection and negative selection. This is a new approach, and nowadays we are using this new approach in many of our crop breeding program. Here, this is an example of chickpea with Cornell University of United States, IRI from India, IIPR from India, and Crisat has developed genomic prediction models for yield-related traits in the case of chickpea, and our prediction are going up to 0.91% also. So you can see this is really good method. Similarly, after doing further improvement, like for instance, we started to use multi-environment trials, and then we also have developed these models, and now we are taking these models further at the larger plots. In the case of groundnut, also we have developed the genomic prediction models, especially for the traits like 50% flowering, days to maturity, 100 seed weight, for all these things. And then you can see we are having the genomic prediction more than 0.6%. In the case of pigeon pea, we are having the hybrid breeding. And hybrid breeding, you make the crosses from that cytoplasmic melistility-based hybrid breeding system we are having. Again, by sequencing and phenotyping these lines, we have developed the genomic prediction models in the case of pigeon pea, and we are moving ahead. So for instance, by using this approach, we have predicted some parental combinations. And now, after this prediction, now we have made those crosses in the real life, and now these combinations are being tested at IAPR. So this is the way we are happening. So as I said, so basically in the future breeding, we need to have the haplotype-based breeding. We need to have the genomic prediction like this red color line. This is the current scenario, but you can do by genomic prediction this blue color line or green color line, that how we can move on. Similar is the case for the different trait. So you can use these different approaches for the genomic prediction. Nowadays, you might have heard some new approach, gene editing or genome editing. And for that work, the inventor for this technology, they were also given the Nobel Prize last year, Jennifer Doudna and other colleagues. And here in the gene editing, what you do, that you identify a nucleotide which is responsible for that particular trait. Now, for instance, which nucleotide makes chickpea seed bigger or smaller? And if you know that, well, by this nucleotide, you are having a smaller, you just need to replace that particular nucleotide. So you edit the gene in the process called gene editing. For that, there are many approaches, meganuclease, zinc finger proteins, TALENs, CRISPR-Cas, etc. CRISPR-Cas has become very, very popular approach. And nowadays there are many examples of use of this CRISPR-Cas. And here I just highlight an example of rice coming from Italy and from Germany and United States collaboration, where they use the 3000 rice genome sequence analysis, promoter analysis. Based on these things, they identify the nucleotide in the promoter region of the three SWEET genes, SWEET 11, SWEET 13, SWEET 14. And then they did this gene editing, and then they developed the genome edited bacterial blight lines. And also they did the pyrimiding. So basically by using this kind of approach, that you can develop the genome editing bacterial blight lines, and you can also pyrimide. And we also wrote this commentary on that one, that how you can use the gene editing approach to develop the varieties for combating bacterial blight in rice. So this is very, very powerful approach. But for this kind of approach, you need to have the gene. And many times people do the transcriptome analysis, proteome analysis. That's okay. But in my opinion, they really do not give you the real gene, the real nucleotide responsible for the trait. What you need to do, and recently we have given this concept, that we need to use the systems biology approach. And systems biology approach, basically the integration of different omics technology, including genomics, transcriptomics, proteomics, metabolomics, and then you integrate these things with the network biology. You bring that artificial intelligence and simulation model. And based on all these things, if you use all these approaches, you will be able to identify the gene. You will be able to identify the nucleotide in the gene. And then you should be able to use those nucleotide for the gene editing approach. So now you can use these approaches. Now there is another approach that you use, either haplotype based breeding, genomic selection, or gene editing, or any new other approach. If your breeding cycle still remains long, then this is not good. What does it mean? That when you do the variety, make the cross, go from F1 to F6, I mean, many crops, it takes 6 to 7 years to reach F6 lines. Long back, there was a process, subtle breeding, that you can keep on doing these things at one location, at two different locations in 1 year. So basically, you can reduce this time from 7 years to just 3 to 4 years. But speed breeding, this approach is promoted from University of Queensland. And then in that approach, they say that speed breeding, so basically they let plant sleep only for 2 hours out of 24 hours, and then they specialize lights, or so they continue to keep these plants awake for 22 hours. And by using these approach, you can have the 6th generation in a single year. So you just imagine that earlier you were taking 6-7 years, now you are taking just 1 year to reach all these 6 generations. I think this is a really good, powerful approach. So now we need to integrate the speed breeding in these different approaches. So in summary, and recently some of these journals, including Nature Biotechnology and the Trends in Plant Sciences, they asked, where is the future of the crop breeding? So especially they asked that in their Nature Biotechnology, and then be told that, well, if we need to address these issues of the climate change, food health, and nutrition security, we anticipate generation of massive amount of sequencing data, not only at the single cell level in plants, but also at the population level from the field. And it will be really important to see the integration of artificial intelligence and machine learning to these data sets to enhance the accuracy of the genomic prediction. Same way in the Trends in Plant Science, we told that, well, now plant breeding based community needs to move towards the breeding with desired
genomes. Just like that, nah.
And in this case, here the data science, including AI, machine learning, they can play very, very important role. And in coming years, we believe we will have the high amount of the sequencing data. We will be having high amount of the phenotyping data. How we can combine these data together, and then we can think of breeding the better lines or better varieties. So I think that this is the way that things need to happen in future. So the take home message from this presentation is, the genomic innovations, they enhance the precision and efficiency of crop improvement program. Translational genomics has already come of the age in so-called even orphan crops. I talked about the genomics assisted breeding success story. Now for future genomics assisted breeding 2.0 approaches, like haplotype based breeding, genomic selection, gene editing, along with the speed breeding, they're expected to accelerate variety development process further. And we believe that even if you can have the varieties, they need to reach to the farmers in the real time. And after that, farmers should also be provided the information about using good agronomy packages. And then they should also be connected to the market so that they can realize the full genetic potential. For research, international, national, and local governmental agency support research is really very, very important. And we need to have the conducive policy environment in the country, especially when you are talking about the GM or gene editing approaches. So with these words, I would like to close my presentation and would like to thank you all. And before that, I would like to thank all my colleagues and collaborators here at the Center of Excellence in Genomics and Systems Biology and other programs at ICRISAT, and all of our collaborators around the world. We had really privileged to collaborate with large number of partners around the world. So with these words, thank you very much, and I will be very happy to take up any question if you have.